In this episode of The Full Nerd, the state of 4K PC gaming, an Intel crazy VR build, and what's up with our builds. Welcome to The Full Nerd, episode 31, recorded on September 11th, 2017. I'm Gordon Ma-Ung with co-host Brad Charkas and Elaine Yee. Controlling the vertical and horizontal is Dan. Dan's name from last week.
What?
Sorry.
He's screaming out the wrong notes.
What I like is I'm reading directly off the screen.
Man,
though.
I...
is Adam.
Oh, his feelings are hurt.
I don't have his name written down, so
his
I don't remember what it is
I've
now.
I've been gone for the single episode, and you already replaced me. Wow.
And controlling
how
the vertical
rude.
And horizontal is Adam Patrick Murray.
Hey, you know what? I had some fun on an airplane with a PC.
Really?
Last week, I took a trip to New York, and rather than taking my 15-inch MacBook Pro that is company-issued, I was like, hey, do we have any 13-inch Dell XPS 13s, I can take on the plane? And man, that was a great PC laptop, or a laptop, like, for on the plane. It was just so, compact.
Yeah. 13s
and I could just
awesome.
Get so much done, and it, like, no bezel. I mean, that keyboard is a little small, but you're on an airplane, you know? Like,
By Dell.
And, yeah. Also,
inside.
On the way back, I partially edited the video.
Really?
That I had shot in New York. Yeah.
On a Dell XPS 13
yeah,
dual core.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
So, and I'm going to bring this up, because if Damon at, and you don't know this inside baseball, if Damon at Dell is watching, I am going to send them back. I just have to find the boxes. Adam did ask to borrow one. I said, do you want to borrow a different brand? Because I know he would, but yes, but now of course you get your free shout out. So you did this not, I don't want to derail this because we're going to talk about state of 4K gaming, but, and we are going to actually keep it to 1 hour. We're on time for the first time ever. We're going to keep it to 1 hour. But I had the same experience. I always thought, now there's rumors of the new Intel. No, it's confirmed, right? It's confirmed. Quad core in the...
Yes.
Okay, it is confirmed. I don't even know what we can talk about. But quad core in an ultrabook, which is like this. This is an ultrabook.
Yes.
This is an HP Spectre.
These are both actually
even
HP
though it's
Spectres.
Got an Apple sticker on it just to troll you. And I was like, what do I want a quad core CPU in something this light for, right? Because it's just like, you think, I'm just going to do Chrome, or, browser, email, normal kind of office stuff. I'm not going to really, what the hell do I need a quad core CPU for? But did you find it didn't hurt you? Because I actually was like, I had to convert some surround 360 surround video. I was like, oh, I wish I had a quad core for this. Now, of course, because I'm saying it didn't make any sense. Now I'm like, I really need a quad core for this.
Well, so I didn't export it because I was like, I'm going to do the final color correction on a bigger screen.
Okay.
Like, I'm not comfortable with that screen. So,
you don't know.
So I didn't export, but I mean, through the editing, I mean, I had multicam footage in there. I had, plenty of effects layers on, like it ran fine. I mean, I think I got pretty close in the RAM because that's only 16 gig in there, I think. So
yeah,
like I couldn't really run Chrome and Premiere at the same time, but it was great. I had a good time with it. So,
and that's going to be tough because you can't really, I don't think there's LPDDR4 in much quantity yet and that's affordable. So they're all going to mostly be 16 gigs max with LPDDR3.
So
I just thinking, you get an XPS 13, you get this quad core 8th gen, whatever the heck it is part. And then you got Nvidia's got this new Pascal super low end power, super low power, not necessarily faster than a previous Maxwell gen part, but more power efficient. And I mean, you could theoretically get, because Acer did it in a Surface clone, you could theoretically get discrete graphics and a quad core CPU in something this light and thin, which is insane.
Which, yep. I mean, for somebody like me, like I said, I was traveling, so I would typically, have something beefier. But since I was traveling, I was like, I need something real small but powerful, and that was great. So I would happily take a quad core because I'd be able to use it. Yeah.
Yeah, for the acceleration, for the CUDA acceleration Premiere, you really could, I mean... The world will be different. In 2017, we're going to be in a different world for these ultrabooks. I got it.
In the second half, yeah.
Second half.
Well, then do you think Max-Q is going to hit any of that stuff?
I think Max-Q is probably too tough.
I mean, the CPU itself is 15 watts. I can't imagine that you're going to put anything in there discrete-wise that's going to be that much more. relatively speaking, IP-wise.
And even on this new NVIDIA Pascal part, it's not really, they're not, they're saying, I think, maybe 20%, 25% faster than the, you know, like a 940MX, which, you know, you got to admit, the 940MX, some of the Intel Iris Plus parts, they were like stepping right up to that 940 part. So this does keep them a little ahead, but I think NVIDIA is really going for, you know, the compute performance out of this. So because they're all, if you look at the website for this new NVIDIA part, it's all about Premiere, it's all about Photoshop, all about the CUDA performance. So they're not really pushing it as a gaming part, although it does perform a little better. So, well, we've totally hijacked that. Sorry. Now, the thing that you care about.
You're watching a show called The Full Nerd when that was the introduction.
That was the intro.
I love it when Gordon always starts the episode and he says, not to go off the rails or anything. And then, like, it's just a segue for like 10 minutes.
Off the rails. If you have kids, your kids will love trains. Choo-choo. Okay.
Kids love trains.
Brad is here to talk about the cool stuff, though, which is the state of 4K gaming. I was asking Brad before this, like, so what now? What's changed in 4K gaming that's significant?
So what changed this year is, obviously, the Radeon Vega parts just came out. And much earlier this year, the GTX 1080 Ti. So a couple years ago, I think it was November 2015. So just, you know, less than 2 years ago, we started this article, The State of 4K Gaming, to kind of get a feel for what you need in your PC if you're going to be looking to get into 4K gaming. At the time, you had to spend a minimum of like $1,300 on a monitor and a graphics card to be able to play at 4K. It wasn't even that great 4K. It was like, you know, with the help of a FreeSync or G-Sync monitor, the higher end cards like the Fury X and the 980 Ti could hit 45 plus. So with the FreeSync or G-Sync, it could smooth out. That level was $1,300 less than 2 years ago. So I went through everything again just now, or earlier this week or last week, I forget, to see where things stand. Now that Vega's out, GTX 10 series here, 1080 Ti is here. And you can still spend that much money just on your monitor and a graphics card. But that's only if you're looking for the highest end performance. Like if you're looking to get a GTX 1080 Ti with a fancy G-Sync monitor, you can still spend $1,400. But if you want to get into 4K gaming with something like a Vega 56, theoretically, if it was selling at MSRP, and a FreeSync monitor, you can get into 4K gaming for about $700, $750 right now. So it's come down almost half in under 2 years.
And that would be 60 frames a second, or the FreeSync requirement, I'm guessing, is saying a little less than that sometimes.
Yeah, that's the thing. One of the exciting things about now is that there's like different tiers you could get into. So like I consider the entry level for 4K gaming to be a Vega 56 or a GTX 1070, which isn't going to hit 60 frames per second in 99% of modern games. But if you pair it with a FreeSync or G-Sync monitor, you'll have a totally fine experience, because I know I've played on these myself. With the FreeSync or G-Sync, it makes it up pretty well.
So another question I have, though, is that 60 frames per second requirement that all sort of PC gamers sort of want, that holy grail of gaming, that's what you need, your minimum. That's at ultra to very high, basically maxed out settings in a game.
It depends on what level of graphics card you're buying. For this, you're probably going to want, if you get a GTX 1070 or a, you know, a Vega 56, you probably want to go to high, which is a step down below ultra, which I think is honestly the sweet spot of gaming anyway, because it still looks great, and ultra typically just gives you a crazy performance hit, and it's not worth it. So
yeah, you know, that kind of brings up what Roger was saying. We interviewed Roger at CES, and he was saying, you know what? You know, I know everybody likes, they always want to shoot for ultra. They want the very high and all this. They want to slide everything to the right side of the screen. But, you know, it doesn't really get you much. He's saying, yeah, are we being sort of led astray? Should we really, because the developers aren't really putting all the effort into making these ultra, truly ultra. They just kill performance. So, you know, maybe 4K at medium to high.
I have like all the latest graphics cards because I'm the graphics card tester, and my go-to whenever I boot up a new game is to go to high unless I'm performance testing, because I find that's the best mix of performance and eye candy.
Huh.
So
Brad, question for you. When you are playing on high with like, say, 1070, are you still leaving on anti-aliasing, or are you turning that off because it's 4K?
It depends on the game. I try it first with none, because a lot of games you honestly don't need it unless you have a gigantic screen. If I find I need it, I start at the low end to work my way up to find where it's acceptable. Hmm. Usually you don't need it or you barely need it. So that actually greatly helps with frame rates.
Huh. All right. I should try that. Because, yeah, at home I have a Dell 27-inch 4K, but it's not G-Sync. You know, I do a lot of work on it, so I needed the 4K. But I have a 1070, and, yeah, for the most part, you know, I'm able to run stuff. But, yeah, usually high is the sweet spot, except for things like Doom, which, you know, are crazy optimized.
So you play 4K 1070 high, right?
Yes. Yeah, somewhere around there. And you know, yeah, I'll mess around with which sliders I think are more important to me. Like, I always prefer a good draw distance so I can kind of, you know, see things as they show up and you know, yeah, take down other things. So,
like, for me, I play on a 1080 on a 1600p panel. I'm old school. I run everything to the right because, you know, why not, right? Something's not right. If I wanted low resolution, I'd get a console, right? So I run everything to the right.
Just had to slip that right in.
Just had to slip that in. Is there anything to convince me? Like, do I really need 4K? What do I get out of it? I play in a 30-inch monitor, right? Old school, you know, cold cathode backlighting. It's, you know, it gets hot, it's just ancient. I'm like, I guess 4K would be nice, but I kind of think, like, do I really need it? Because for me, I sort of think 4K with my vision, I need minimum of 32 inches on the panel. Is it really worth it?
It's funny because I was talking with Ed from Sapphire on this. He left a comment on a PCWorld Facebook post and we were chatting back and forth. I honestly think for most gamers, considering the price of a monitor and the kind of graphics firepower you need to run 4K gaming, I still think that an ultra-wide monitor, so like 3440 by 1440, I think it is, or a 1440 high refresh rate monitor is probably still the sweet spot.
Right.
Especially because if you like really high frame rates, like a lot of people don't even want to play at 60, they want to play at 100 plus. And you can't get that in 4K right now. Right now, 4K monitors are 60 hertz. So I think the sweet spot's still 1440p.
1440 at high refresh, right?
Yep. Yeah. Or ultra wide. I have a hankering for ultra wide. I kind of want to upgrade to an ultra wide monitor. It takes, it's so pretty and it takes a lot less GPU power too. Cause even though it has a ton of pixels, it has significantly less than 4K.
Well, what's the game support on those? Have they typically been pretty good?
It's getting better. It's going in the opposite direction of multi GPU support. Support is getting worse.
Yeah, it's dead. I have to admit that.
I got to say that, everyone in the chat on YouTube, at least, you know, thinks 4K is kind of a gimmick, or, you know, they would much rather have a high refresh rate or the ultra wides, like Brad was saying. So, yeah, you know, like I said, for me, you know, 4K, I need it for editing and stuff like that. Right. But, you know, like if it was just purely gaming, yeah, I'd probably check out a G-Sync or something.
Gordon,
I really, really like it for like strategy games in particular, because you can just see a lot more of the map. And if you can see more of the map, you can kick a lot more ass. So
Sims are nice too. When I've tried it,
yeah.
Have you not tried ultra wide? Yeah, have you not tried ultra wide?
I have.
Before?
I have not done a lot of game. You know, one of my favorite games is World of Warships, and ultra wides are awesome for that, because instead of looking at this, you're looking at this, and you sort of get the cheat in a way, because you can sort of see the ships over here, and you can it's an advantage.
I think you should try it.
Well, but see, I play. You know, I'm on 1610. And I basically have an ultra wide. I just have an ultra tall too, so I get the extra top and bottom. So I'm not really sold on ultra wide myself, but I really, if I had the money right now, I would do a high refresh rate 1440p panel. That's sort of like my fantasy is an IPS 1440, because I do like a little more color accuracy. So if I could get 120, 144. That Asus panel that we had, you know, last year, that was a beautiful panel for that. Except for the light bleed in the corner, but I think that'd be awesome. That's sort of like my fantasy panel.
That was pretty, yeah. Well, and that's another thing, that the panel quality on those ultra wides, like I think it was it the Predator with the curved ultra wide, the
Predator 21X, the laptop.
No, the screen we got in last year.
Oh yes,
like
yes.
Man,
that was no. Actually, you're thinking about the different. You're thinking about there's an Origin, and a lot of people made it. There's an all-in-one. It was an incredible all-in-one. Basically, somebody figured out how to glue a mini ITX motherboard.
Yeah, that's what it was.
And a full-size video card and water cooling inside of an all-in-one. The thing is just like, it just hammered in performance, but that screen was just...
That panel
just,
quality was real bad.
It was like right on the border of like a deal breaker. It was just sad. You remember, it was like, if you had your head in a brace and you didn't turn it, it was fine. But I can't see anything.
Better or worse than that Dell Latitude budget gaming laptop?
It was better than that. That was like, that screen they used was a low bar of like...
the lowest bar of
that
like...
That was pretty bad.
But it really was almost a deal breaker. But I have seen better widescreen. The Predator was better. So the one you're thinking of is the Predator G-Sync. That was actually... The off-axis was better than that. But whatever vendor that... for that all-in-one that basically everybody sourced for that, it was just sort of like, it's just like, oh, just... It would kill you if you bought it almost. It was... But it was just so nice to get all-in-one with... That was upgradable. If you bought that thing, you could upgrade it. You could put a full-size video card. They had a Titan X non-Pascal, non-P in it, and an 8-core processor in an all-in-one, which is crazy.
It was a desktop processor, too, right?
And it was a desktop processor, and it was in a socket, and, you know, we're talking back then, of course, it was probably a Broadwell E or something, but still.
Yeah, that was nice. We got a good question on YouTube from Fact of Reality TV. he's asking, missed it. What do you feel about the minimum disk requirement for read and writes for fluid gaming, especially for something like 4K or high refresh rates? You know?
The minimum what requirement?
He's saying how much of an impact of on the on drive, so drive IO is
SSD,
how much of it?
HDD.
Does that really hurt any of the 4K gaming? My experience, of course, I don't play a lot of 4K. Are you finding, what are you running in your machine?
I just have a
5400 RPM hard drive? WD green drive?
If you're having a GTX 1080 and a 4K monitor, you probably have an SSD. And if you have an SSD, then there's nothing to worry about. I haven't tested a 4K machine with a traditional hard drive, so...
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
You know,
some people store their games on a secondary drive and use that as like long-term storage. I personally like to swap the games I'm actively playing over to my SSD for the better results. So I can understand the question. I don't have an answer for it.
Yeah. So my answer though is I for the most part, it doesn't really matter. Unfortunately, and I will say that because I like things that push hardware, things that go, wow, this is so much better. It's worth it for me to buy it. But game developers, by and large, are very conservative. They're not going to go out and they're going to... And let me rewind the clock back even further to the early 2000s or mid-2000s. Intel was pitching people on their SSDs because it actually improved game performance. And this this is actually true. On the original Crysis, if you ran it with an SSD, you got better frame rates, which is crazy, right? And it's just something with the way Crysis loaded in the levels. For some reason, it did affect performance. And then Intel was saying, hey, you know, by the way, we're trying to work with the developers. So, you know, there's none of those level pauses, you know, because you'll be running on an SSD. It'll be optimized for an SSD. The game will just be completely fluid and you're just not going to get these lags from loading in levels. Well, developers have figured out, you know, we're loading it. They're loading it in without affecting performance, but the bar is still pretty low. They're not going to go out and say, oh, yeah, we made this for a 960 Pro. If you have a 960 Pro, it's going to be awesome. Everybody else below that, if you've got your entry-level super cheap-ass TLC SSD, yeah, it's going to suck. Well, developers can be like, then we're going to get burned to hell in the Steam, right? People can say, it doesn't run well on my $5 SSD. So, unfortunately... It doesn't really impact it. They are very clever about loading in all the textures, loading in all the assets without impacting game performance as much as possible. I know we all kind of wish they would go and say, oh, yeah, you know, use all the hardware we have. But at the same time, I will say most people then will say, oh, my God, this game is so badly optimized. When the opposite is like, no, we've optimized it for good hardware, not your cheap hardware. But then people say, no, you're not optimized. Well, you don't have a tri-SLI system. Well, no, but nobody supports that. You know, so it's tough being a game developer. So,
Fact of Reality TV, he's following up. He's saying he really wants to test your knowledge on this subject, Gordon. So he's really, he wants to hold your feet to the fire here. He's saying specifically his question is, what's the minimum data rate to run a smooth 60 frames a second at 4K? He's testing your knowledge, calling you out, Gordon.
I would say, you know, and again, I don't play on a 4K machine. Realistically, it's going to change, right? Some games, for the most part, most games are not going to be I/O bound, right? So I don't know. I don't know. And actually, this is one of the things Adam and I were talking about testing, because we want to be able to test, like, let's build identical boxes. You know, this is an argument you hear all the time. Most gamers will say you don't need an NVMe drive. Just go with the SATA drive, right? Because you're getting bang for the buck. You're getting a lot of capacity. Who cares if it's SATA? No games are going to need more than, you know, 500 meg read writes. You don't need that 1.5 gigs. We want to test that in a game to see if it makes a difference. I could imagine there might be some games that, like, yeah, you know what? Not even 4K, but if you're running, what was that? Wasn't Far Cry? Was the one that came out, Wildlands or something, right? That was just
Ghost Recon Wildlands.
Oh my God, that thing barely loaded. If you had like a RAID 960, it would just take forever just to load anyway. Yep. So there's some things, yeah, it might. I will say there's some things that it will make a difference. But I don't think it's because the developer says, yeah, we're going to go out and we're going to make it so you need 1.5 gigs read-write to run our game. It's because they're like, well, we didn't have time to optimize this for the people running those 300 meg SATA drives. So, you know, it is what it is. So that's my answer. It is something we do want to test. But I would say the vast majority of games, it's not going to kill you. It's not like you're going to like lose the game I don't think it's going to impact your frame rates like it did with Crysis. Go ahead. I'll stop talking.
In my personal system, I have a 7200 RPM hard drive that I use for a bunch of games. And there's been a few games I've played directly off of that at 4K with GTX 1080. And it does take forever compared to an SSD to load a stage, to load a level, to get into the game. But once the actual game is going, I haven't experienced any issues that made me go, wow, this is clearly, you know, this hard drive can't handle 4K.
Which makes sense, the caching of the actual, especially what about an open world? Because, you know, usually it's caching on the fly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, clearly it's going to be a little smoother none of us are saying go back to a hard drive. No way. But what we're saying is, yeah, it's unfortunate that I don't think these high performance NVMe drives are.
You know, it would be fun to test. It would be fun to test Intel Optane hard drive on a 7200 RPM with a 4K gaming open world game.
Yeah, that'd be interesting, because I kind of wonder, because, you know, you only really get the performance the first time you cache it, so it will help with the OS load. Yeah, I don't know if it's going to... I know they did say it made a difference. You know, generally, I'm going to say go with a pure SSD most of the time.
But back to the issue at hand.
Yes.
FreeSync. If you're getting anything below a GTX 980, 1080 Ti, it's not going to reliably hit 60 frames per second in most 4K games, the modern ones at least.
G-Sync.
So if you're playing Witcher on a GTX 1080, if you're playing, you know, a bunch of the modern games, you're not going to hit 60 frames per second reliably on either a Vega 64 or a GTX 1080. So FreeSync and G-Sync can really help coming into play there. And that was AMD's pitch for Vega 64. FreeSync can be a lot cheaper, and it truly can be. You can find $300 to $400, $500 FreeSync displays that are 4K. Whereas realistically, you're going to spend $500 plus on a G-Sync display for 4K. But G-Sync has a bunch of extra quality of life features that FreeSync don't. And if you start to look for monitors that have those extra quality of life features in FreeSync, it's going to be comparable when you add the two up. So if you want to get in bare bones, you could go with a Vega 56 if you can find one at the actual $400 sale price. And a $300 monitor would be gaming for $700. Or you could step up to a Vega 64 and a GTX 1080. All those, I would recommend a sync monitor if you can.
What do you think is generally your buy-in then for 4K, like everything? So, because clearly you need a new panel. You're not going to be playing with your old one. We're talking $1,500 then, maybe?
You can get in there for less.
With monitor.
You mean for the whole PC?
The whole.
Well, I'm talking about just the graphics card and the monitor.
Okay.
is what I did.
Oh, I see. That works.
And you can get down to $700 realistically if you can find Vega 56 at its selling price.
Oh, which doesn't seem very likely at the moment. Yeah.
So realistically, you're looking at closer to $800.
Are you even able to buy it in those packs right now?
You can. A whole bunch just turned up on Newegg because they're all selling for $700. Nobody's buying them.
Well, so, not even the miners.
No, that's not, that card's not worth it compared to the 580.
Huh. So what's explaining this shortage? Sorry to we don't know.
A mixture of some people might be mining. There are actually AMD enthusiasts who've been waiting for this card to pair with a FreeSync monitor who want the card. And I wouldn't be surprised if there's a stock shortage. Somewhat related to this, part of I touched on it in the article. This article is focused on like the best quality 4K kind of a deal. Like some people do game at 4K with a 1060 or a 580 and just drop things to medium so that they can get a good frame rate. But with how much graphics cards are selling for these days, if you're willing to make that kind of visual compromise anyway, you might actually save money and be better getting a PlayStation Pro or Xbox One X.
No.
Well, actually, that's what I was going to ask about. You know, how much of an impact does consoles trying to move into 4K have on the PC? Do you think, you know, that's going to help push the PC forward as well?
Well, PCs already has 4K textures and stuff, so it's not like it's adding anything new.
No, but I mean, at least like, you know, getting it more widely accepted, you know, that people are going to be like, oh wow, I should get a 4K monitor on my desktop.
The thing that really interests me is the Xbox One X, because that's going to support FreeSync monitors. And Microsoft's already starting to work in keyboard and mouse support into some Xbox games. So in these days where RX 580 is selling for $400 to $500+, a $500 Xbox console that you can play on a FreeSync monitor doesn't seem so bad, even though you're losing out on all the other wonderful things you get with PC games. You won't get Steam sales.
Yes, but you do get that Blu-ray player, so I guess, you know, depends on what your needs are.
I'm already working on a mod for the Xbox One X. It's actually pretty cool.
Here it comes.
It's a, no. Look, I've already filed for patents, all right? You take the Xbox One X, and it's going to let you mount it vertically. And then when there's mouse and keyboard support.
Okay.
And then we're also going to add, it's got the Blu-ray drive, and then we're going to be able to load Windows on it.
Okay. And well, then, it already does
run a form of Windows on
well,
it.
Well, it'll actually be Windows.
It actually is.
And then
is.
You'll be running your PC. No, okay. Come on.
It actually runs off like a modified version of Windows 10.
No, I understand that, but I don't think it really is ever going to, I don't think it'll help.
Gordon, it's the future. Okay. I'm going to get you one for Christmas.
Yeah.
That's all you're going to use.
You know, they're on the Xbox One S is on sale right now for like crazy low prices.
Really?
Yeah, I think they're just trying to get
fire sale.
It's like $200 right now for a 500 gig one.
Yeah, that's not bad.
Yay, that's great. But I've totally lost track of what was I thinking. Oh, so Brad, you mentioned, and let's see how much time we have. We have 30 minutes left. Brad, you mentioned earlier people who crank it down to medium to play at 4K. Mm-hmm. Now to me, it's like, does that make sense? Wouldn't you rather just run 1080, a lower res at higher quality settings, say high to very high?
That's what I would do. Yeah. But, I mean, if you have a 4K display for work or something like that and you only have a 580 and you really want that extra, you know, on-screen real estate, it is possible. Personally, like, I have a 4K monitor and depending on the game, I already drop it down to 1440p just to hit that consistent 60. I'm a much bigger fan of frame rates over graphical quality.
Yeah,
so.
Same for me.
Because I will say with PC gaming, you know, and you know, we just earlier said going from high to very high to ultra, a lot of times you don't really see that much, right? You can do like if you stop it, take a screenshot and then capture it and then look at it under a microscope, you can sometimes see. But going to medium in
that's
a lot
difference.
Of PC games, it looks like
a console.
I didn't say it.
You were going to say it.
That's arguable though. Like at that point, it just like depends how well they've optimized. You know,
so yeah.
Sometimes it still looks a little better.
Yeah.
Sometimes console looks better.
Maybe sometimes, but I just kind of think like there's some kind of like universal memo that went out to all game developers on the PC that said medium It's all, you can make it as ugly as you want. It's like medium is always just like, it is just like a blurry past, you know, like pastelish colors and just.
Maybe they figured out.
One of my favorite things to do is to put Grand Theft Auto 5, everything jacked except for the textures on medium. And it is just the most garish, ridiculous thing you'll ever see in
your
life.
That's a good idea.
That like actually would be a great topic. So we should just like do comparisons, just like, because it just like, yeah, because I run some games for CPU tests that like, you know, low to medium or whatever. It's just, it's pretty ugly. It's pretty ugly. And I try it on laptops too, right? Because some game, a lot of games, you're going to be playing games at medium settings, and it's like, ooh.
I think I kind of feel that medium is for the people who are just happy to be able to play that game.
That's true,
that
and
system.
We should welcome them.
And I don't think that it's necessarily designed for people who've, you know, spent the money on good equipment.
Yeah, that's true. No, that's a very good point, because I mean, if we don't welcome those people to, you know, those are the people that are going to go like, wow, if I buy a, you know, $150 GPU, I can get so much better graphics quality, right? So that's,
or even people who now in this new era of, you know, quad core stuff with the MX150, that they might say, hey, like, I took this on the plane with me, but let's see if I can still like get like another hour in this game, even though it's not going to look great,
right?
So
as long as there's power, on
there's a time and place for it.
Yeah, no, I guess, but just yeah, medium is just ugly. I just.
I mean, I'm not saying that it's going to be the best thing for your eyes. All I'm just right. saying there's time and place for it.
It's not as bad as, it's only ugly to you because we're used to the high stuff. Like if you don't have a console or you don't have a PC and you throw a GTX 1050 or whatever in a PC, you'd be like, wow, this looks surprisingly good for $100.
Yeah.
Compared to a $500 console or whatever.
And, you know, and as much as people want to bag on 4K being a gimmick on PC, I got to say, once you're on a 32-inch panel, 4K is looking nice, because anything lower, it's getting a little loose with those pixels. So 4K is very nice on really, really big panels. So
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Maybe even a TV, I wonder. Yeah, and I've seen 4K gaming on a PC, and it's with a television. It's pretty nice. So, but all right. So that's
if you want to learn more about it, there's a big, huge article on PCWorld.com. Dives into all the different options, because you can get all kinds of different tiers. It dives into FreeSync versus G-Sync, what you'll save. So go check it out if you want.
It is a great article.
Yep.